Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now, here's a message from Pastor Dan Roth.
Father, we come to you in the mighty name of Jesus. And Lord, we do lift up our nation, God. This great nation, the United States of America, God. We pray for our nation. We pray for our leaders, God. We lift them up to you, God. You said that the king's heart is like a water course in your hand. You direct it wherever you desire. So God, we ask that you would turn the hearts of our leaders towards godliness, towards righteousness, Lord. Sin is a reproach to any nation, God, but righteousness exalts it. And so Lord, we ask, God, that you give us leaders after your own heart. Lord, we pray for this upcoming election year, God, that you would put the right person in office, God, in all of the different areas that are being voted for, God, all the laws that are going to be coming to pass, God. We pray, Lord, that they would be just and upright in your eyes, God, and that they would be favorable to the gospel and to its spread. Lord, we thank you, God, also that you surround our leaders with wise and godly counselors and influences in their lives, Lord, that will turn them towards the ways of God and the will of God and not towards evil or injustice, God. We thank you, Father God, that you just bless our nation, God. May we continue to be benevolent and kind to other nations. May we continue to uphold justice and your goodness, God. May we continue to be generous and givers, Lord. And we thank you, Father God, for your goodness. Thank you for placing us here in this time. Lord, we ask for revival in our land, God. We ask for great awakenings once again, Lord, of righteousness, of your goodness, that churches all over the world be filled, God. We bless all the churches that are preaching the gospel, not just ours this day, God, but all of those, our brothers and sisters that are lifting up the name of Jesus. We ask that you would bless them as you would bless us. Now, Lord, as we open up your word, we ask that you would open it up to us. Open our eyes to see, our ears to hear. May we have hearts that are good ground. May we be the good ground where the word is sown, and may it produce something in each and every one of our individual lives. Truly today, Lord, we did not come to hear from a man or a woman, from the young or the old, from the black, the white, the brown, any other color we could imagine. God, today we came to hear from you. So be welcome in this place. Welcome, Holy Spirit. Be our teacher. Be our guide. Give us the vision, the wisdom, the instruction, the direction, even the correction we need for our lives. Lord, we'll give you the praise and the glory and the honor for it. Jesus' mighty name, we're all in agreement, and we say, amen. Amen. Today you can have a seat. Get your Bibles out. I want to welcome those of you that are joining us online as well. Thank you for joining us. Get your Bible out right where you're at, or we'll have it up on the overheads for you. I believe God's going to speak to you wherever you're at all over the world. Today, it's a great day. We're launching back. We've been in a series talking about the blessed life, and we took a sidestep from the book of Hebrews for that time period while we celebrated last weekend, had a great time celebrating our birthday, 27 years, if you're wondering why the big 27 up there, because the Rock Church World Outreach Center has been going for 27 years, and that's just a neat thing that we celebrated. God's goodness, his faithfulness. And so now this weekend, we're coming back into the book of Hebrews. So get your Bibles out. We're going to be in Hebrews chapter 11. The title of today's message is Through Troubled Waters. We're going to be talking about the story of Noah and the ark. And, you know, just to introduce the subject, I thought I would film a little video just to give you guys a little bit of insight into where we're going. Check out the overheads. The story of Noah has been one that we've been familiar with since we were kids. There were flannel boards, if you remember those from Sunday school. There were popular and very colorful books that we had, even little Teich toys that we got to play with. We understood for the most part that the Lord told Noah to build him an arky-arky, build it out of wood and barky-barky. But then we grew up, we got educated. We started to learn that many cultures around the world have stories of the flood in ancient cultures and societies. Suddenly, rather than building up the validity of the Bible as it should have done, now all of a sudden we started to doubt. We started to wonder about the Bible because it was presented to us in a way that made it into folklore or a mythical event. Recently, Hollywood stepped in to settle the dispute and tell the right story, the accurate account of how Noah actually had dreams and visions and magic tea that helped him to see a vision of what he was supposed to do, and rock creatures came and helped him to build the ark and survive the storm. Now, when I read my Bible, I didn't see any of that. I didn't understand it that way. I didn't think that Noah was a murderous man who wanted to end the world as we know it. Maybe we had it right as kids. Today, let's take a look in the Bible and see what God's Word has to say about Noah, the ark, and your and my life. Got your Bibles? Hebrews chapter 11, verse number 7. We're talking about through troubled waters. Hebrews chapter 11, verse number 7 says this. It says, by faith, Noah, being divinely warned of things not yet seen, moved with godly fear, prepared an ark for the saving of his household, by which he condemned the world and became heir of the righteousness, which is according to faith. Now, let's stop for a second and let's talk about the facts, because this is a real story. This is not just a fairy tale. This is not a myth. This actually took place. This actually happened. And we find in the Bible that there were accounts of Noah and the ark. In fact, his name is mentioned all throughout the Bible. The apostles talked about him. Here we are in the book of Hebrews, talking about Peter, the apostle, talked about him. Jesus talked about Noah. So if Jesus believed in Noah, then guess what? This is God in the flesh talking. It's real and it's true. Now, let me just cover some of the things that were taking place. I wish we had time to go from Genesis chapter 6 all the way through to Genesis chapter number 9 today. It's a fascinating story. It's a great story for all of us. And if you haven't yet read the story of Noah, you need to get into your Bible today. Maybe start Genesis chapter 6 and read straight through to Genesis chapter number 9 and reinforce what you're going to hear today and understand and let God speak to you from the Word of God. But let's just cover the broad spectrum for our time here today in church. First of all, we understand, tell me when this sounds familiar, we understand that there was a population explosion. The Bible says that people were multiplying on the earth. Secondly, we understand that people were going about their business. They were buying and selling, they were marrying and giving in marriage. You know, a lot of talk about marriage these days and a lot of things taking place. Also, we find out that people just were going about their doing their own thing and they had not a single thought of God in their minds. In fact, the Bible tells us that from the time of man's youth, that his heart was bent continually on evil or on wickedness. Sounding familiar yet? And there was troubled waters all around, whether or not there was a flood yet or not, there was things that were taking place. And God said, my spirit will not always strive with man. I will lengthen his days to 120 years. People were living hundreds of years. They were doing evil on the earth. And therefore, God shortened the length of man's days. Now we find a man that was perfect and just in the eyes of God. His name is Noah. He walked before God uprightly like his ancestry did, like Abel, like even though he came from the line of Seth. And now here, one of his ancestors, Enoch, walked with God and God took him. But now we find Noah. Here Noah is and God favors Noah. Noah found grace or favor in the sight of God. There was a special thing on Noah's life. And so the word of the Lord comes to Noah and God tells him that he needs to build an ark. Now, if we're going to survive the troubled waters that we're going through today, because today, as you look around, there's things taking place on the earth. There's wars and rumors of wars. There's earthquakes and famine and plague and flood and things that are taking place. There is trouble going on. And it's not getting any better. If you notice, as you look around, things are getting darker. But guess what? The light is just going to shine brighter in that darkness. God will carry us through those troubled waters. So if we're going to make it, we're going to have to take a look at Noah and do what Noah did if we're going to be preserved the way Noah was preserved. First of all is that we find out that Noah prepared. Noah prepared. It says that Noah heard the word of the Lord, that he had faith, he believed God, and he was moved with godly fear, and he prepared an ark for the saving of his household. Now, how did Noah prepare? How much preparation was needed? Think about this for a second. For Noah, and let's assume that his family built the ark with him. So 8 people, how much preparation would be needed for him to make the ark? Well, again, let's take a look at some of the facts, because people have often looked at the story of the ark and they've said, oh, I don't know if that's real. I don't know if that's true. I don't know if that's going to make it. But how much preparation was needed? See, the ark that Noah built would have been 450 feet long, 75 feet wide, and 45 feet tall. So that would have been roughly the size, think about an NFL pro football field, right? Goalpost to goalpost, the ark would have been longer than the goalpost, and it would have been just about as wide as that field, and then 3 stories tall, okay? So you guys got that picture in your head? It would have been about half the size of the Queen Mary II, that cruise liner. It would have been about half the size of that. Now, people who work in the industry of shipping and freight, they looked at the size of the ark, the dimensions, and even though we might think of that as a big rectangular box, right, they say that actually would have been great dimensions for it to be. It would have been able to have survived a 100-foot wave, okay? Now, what about the capacity, okay? There were 3 levels to the ark. There was 1 door, and there was 1 window at the top that light and fresh air could come into. There was 1 doorway that went into the ark, and there was 3 levels that God told Noah to build. And therefore, the capacity, the shipping capacity, could have been the same as if you had 500 freight cars. Okay? That's quite a capacity. You could have taken the Statue of Liberty and set it on the inside of the ark with the pedestal, all right? And it would have been able to hold the Statue of Liberty and as well carry its weight. That's pretty neat when you think about it. Now, sometimes people say, well, wait a second. Okay, I get that Noah could have built the ark, but, you know, how long would that have taken? Well, from the time that we first are introduced to Noah, it says that Noah was 500 years old when he had his three sons, okay? The next time you see Noah going into the ark, Noah is now 600 years old. It could have been that the Lord spoke to Noah on his 500th year and that it took him 100 years, up to 100 years to build the ark. That's pretty amazing. That's a lot of preparations. That's a whole lot of wood. That's a whole lot of work. You say, well, wait a second. What about gathering the animals? How could Noah have gone around the world and gathered up all the animals? Well, you got to read your Bible. The Bible says that God brought the animals to Noah and they went into the ark with him. You say, well, wait a second, there's millions of species of animals on the planet. How could they all have fit on one ark? Well, remember, we talked about 500 shipping containers worth of storage capacity. Now, out of those millions of animals, you have to take the sea life, all of the marine life, all the sea life. You could take all those out of the equation because they're in water, right? And if God floods the earth, they have no need to be on the ark, okay? They're going to survive anyways, okay? But then let's take all the insects. Most of those millions you'll find are these little species that they keep finding in the Amazon rainforest or different places on the earth, and they're finding new species all the time. But a lot of those are real small. So if you took all of the land animals, insects, mammals, right, worms, whatever else you got, and you categorize those, brought those down into two by two, it would have filled 150 train cars. Okay, those shipping freight cars, there's 150 of those that would have been filled if you, let's say you went on average, okay, from the small gnat to the greatest sized elephant or giraffe or whatever it is, and put them all in the size of about a sheep. You would have been able to fill up 150 freight cars worth of animals. Now remember, this ark had a shipping capacity of 500, okay, so they would have been well able to carry the load. And guess what else? There was only 8 people, so there would have been room for more people to get on the ark. Isn't that amazing when you think about it, the mercy and the love of God? And so when we take a look at this, we know that Noah had faith. We know that he had heard the word of God. We know that he acted in faith and he prepared the ark. Now, keep your finger there in Hebrews chapter 11. And I want to show you a verse in Genesis chapter number 6, okay? I want you to take a look in your Bible, first book of the Bible, Genesis chapter number 6. And I want to point out a verse to you that most of the time when we read verses like this, we think that God is just telling us the story, that he kind of had to include this verse because, you know, it just kind of concludes this thought or concludes the story for us. And we skip over verses like this because we think it really doesn't have any significance. God's just telling us the story. And yet when you look at what we're talking about, it has great significance for our lives. Genesis chapter number 6, verse number 22 says this, "Thus Noah did, according to all that God commanded him, so he did." In other words, Noah got to work. And Noah not only got to work, he prepared. That he worked hard. He labored. And eventually, Noah finished the work that God had called him to do. See, in our lives, we need to understand that there is a work of faith. We cannot sit idly by and expect God to do everything for us. We need to get to work on his word. See, there was a work of faith that Noah did. Noah served. Noah worked hard at this. Noah probably worked for hundreds of years tirelessly at this ark because he had heard the word of God. He had faith and he believed God. He knew that there was a flood that was coming and therefore he went after it. Now, if you're wondering why this faith thing hasn't been working out for you, could it be that you haven't been working out? Think about that for a second. Let me describe this for you. There's faith, but faith without works is what? Dead, right? And so we have to understand that we need to put some legs to our faith. I love how William Booth, founder of the Salvation Army, said it. He said that faith and works are like two legs. First, there's faith. You believe God, but then you get to work on the word of God. And then you hear the word and you believe God, and then you get to work on it. One right after the other until almost you can't tell which one's which. And you're moving in the direction that God has called you to. Let's take a good example of this. How about this? Healing. You find that in the Bible. We're promised healing. You can hear the word of God and believe God for your healing and say, yes, I believe it. I receive it, therefore. And God, I want to be healed. And therefore, God, thank you for healing me. And you can do nothing in the natural. And yes, passively, you can receive your healing. You can believe God and still receive it. Just like Noah, right? Noah heard the word that there was going to be a flood. Noah couldn't do anything about bringing water on the earth. Is that right? He couldn't go and splash in the water or, you know, try and throw something at the heavens and make rain came down or anything like that. He couldn't do any of that. He had to passively believe the word of God that there would be a great flood that would come, and then he had to trust that God was going to bring that word to pass. But actively, he heard the word of God that there was a flood coming, and he needed to prepare for the flood, and therefore he went to work on the boat. So back to our example of healing, right? You may passively understand that God is the healer. He's the one that's going to touch you. He's the one that's going to heal you. But then actively, you can get to work on your health by eating right, by exercising, by going to the doctor and seeing if there's anything they could tell you about it, by how about confessing the word and praying and believing God. See, there are things that we can do. If you've been believing God for provision, you found the word on provision, you say, oh, well, my God shall supply all my needs according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. I believe that God is going to get me a job to provide for my needs, but then you never put in an application. Come on. I'm not going to get a job. No, you need to put some legs to your faith. I'm going to believe God for a job, and I'm going to go beat the streets. I'm going to go knock on doors. They're going to be annoyed with me. I'm going to dress right so that they know that I'm not just some chump coming in off the street. Hello. And I'm going to make sure they know my name, even if they're using it as a curse word. Oh, here they come again, right? Eventually, they'll have to give you a job because they'll see you're on time, you're trustworthy, you're faithful, you're hardworking, you really want that job. They got to give you a job, right? Then you put the favor of God on top of it, and they got no choice. See, Noah was prepared to do the work of God. He got to work. But how about this one? Second thing that we see, if we're going to make it through these troubled waters, got to do what Noah did, in that he persevered. Noah persevered. Think about it. It took years to build the ark. Probably decades. Could have taken up to 100 years. He had to persevere in order to do that. Now, if you add up all the number of days that Noah was on the ark, you'll find out it's 371 days from the time he entered the ark till the time he exited the ark. That's over a year. Do you think that in all the time that Noah was building the ark, or that all the time that Noah was actually on the ark, that he had opportunity to be discouraged? Do you think he had opportunity to say, well, wait a second, has God really spoken to me about this? Am I crazy? Am I just dreaming things? Did I drink some magic tea? I mean, what's going on here? Do you think that Noah had an opportunity to give up and say, well, maybe this isn't what God really wanted me to do. Maybe I missed God. I'm crazy. Now let's dream for a second, okay? Because if you read in the Bible, this account is before the flood, right? So the account of the earth that we have so far is that the creation account, right? That God created the heavens and the earth, and that God took the waters from below and the waters from above, and he separated them from each other. So there could have been, and he says he gathered all the waters on the earth to one place, and out of it came the dry land. He called the land, right? And therefore there was the waters above, the waters beneath, there was land all gathered to one place. Now in our science classes, we learned about a phenomenon called Pangaea, right? It was one land mass. And if you look at the continents as they are today, you understand that they've drifted apart and that they look like a puzzle piece. If you look at South America and Africa, they fit right together. And so there could have been one land mass. And it could have been, as it said in the Garden of Eden, that the water came up from out of the ground and was a cool mist in the morning that watered all the plants. Potentially, they could have never seen rain before on the earth. Here's Noah. He's got the word of the Lord that there will be a flood that is coming and that God is going to destroy all of life on the earth. So Noah starts to build a boat on dry land, and everybody knows it. Think about this. Decades he's building this boat. Probably one of the neighbors came out one morning. Frame just got put up. He looks out and he's, what on earth is that? Hey, honey, you see what Noah's doing over here? And he's got his kids working on that. Hey, Noah, what are you doing? What do you mean rain? I don't even know what that is. God's going to do what? Nah, you're crazy. Right? Year later, 5 years later, 10 years later. Noah, you still working on that boat? Listen, there's not a drop. Nothing's happened yet. Noah, you're crazy. Hey, Shem, Ham, Japheth, what are you guys doing? You need to leave your old dad alone. You've entertained this long. Come on, we're having barbecue. Guys, come on over for some barbecue. Just put down the hammers, put down the saws. Let's have some fun. See, Noah and his son, they had opportunities to give up. What about there on the ark? Here he is, the first month goes by, All the animals, okay, praise God, we made it through, you know, storm, the breaking up of the deep. What was that like? My goodness. Think about the thunderings. Think about the ocean. Think about the waves. Think about the darkness and the chaos that they thought about. But then the second month comes, and the rain stops. Oh, wow, we made it. God is good. God is faithful. Then the third month. Then the fourth month. Then the fifth month. Then the sixth. I mean, think about this. You're probably looking out over, and it wasn't until a long while that finally they landed on dry ground, until finally they could, hey, look, I can finally see the tops of mountains out there. See, they were on the boat. Do you think they ever could have wondered, did God give up on us? Did God forget us here on this little teeny tiny boat on the waters? I mean, when is God going to do something? And yet, I love the verse that says that God remembered Noah. See, church, if we're going to make it through the troubled waters that are all around us, we have to know that God knows right where we're at. God knew the plan. God knew what he was going to do. God knows how long it's going to take. And our job is to persevere. We need to go through. And God will carry us. See, Noah's motivation was not external. If it was external, he would have given up. If it was external, man, when the people were making fun of him and jeering and you know, he could have just gave up and said, that's it, I'm done. This is crazy. If his motivation was external, he could have said, there's not been a drop of water for decades, and yet I'm sitting here building this stupid boat. You know, he could have gave up. If his motivation was external there on the ark, he could have given up and said, you know what, I'm despairing of life. I haven't heard the voice of God. You know what, it probably would have been better for us to perish with the rest of the world. Let's go jump off the boat and die. See, he had plenty of opportunity to give up, and yet he had faith. He believed God. He heard the word of God, and because of it, he was moved with godly fear. Hebrews chapter 11, verse number 7, once again, look at what it says. By faith, Noah, being divinely warned of things not yet seen, moved with godly fear. He had the fear of the Lord on his life. That's why he worked, and that fear turned into a fervency, turned into diligence. Remember, without faith, it's impossible to please God, because those who come to us believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. See, so faith comes, you hear the word of God, you believe it, you receive it. Now there is a fear of the Lord that falls on me. My goodness, judgment is coming. We've got a work to do. We need to get prepared. We need to get ready. And then that fear turns into a fervency, and you work with all your heart at it. You endure and you persevere. See, it's no different in our lives. Let me show it to you there in Hebrews chapter 11. Turn with me to Hebrews chapter 12. Hebrews chapter 12, last two verses in Hebrews chapter 12, verse 28 and verse number 29. Take a look at what it says. Hebrews chapter 12, verse number 28, starting out, says this: therefore, since we are receiving a kingdom which cannot be shaken, let us have grace. Just like Noah found grace in the eyes of God, let us have grace, by which we may serve God acceptably with reverence. And what are those two words right there? Godly fear, just like Noah. See, your motivation cannot be external. You can look at what the government is doing. You can look at what the nation is doing. You can look at what pop culture society is doing. You can look at what the education systems are doing, and you will get discouraged. You will get downcast. You will get depressed. Doesn't matter what news channel you're broadcasting, it's always going to be broadcasting bad news. And yet you cannot let your motivation be external. If you look at the bank account, you look around, you look all at what people are doing, you will give up. But when you are motivated with godly fear, when you have faith and you believe the word of God and the fear of the Lord falls on you, now you have a motivation that won't quit and won't give up. Let us serve God acceptably with reverence and godly fear. Look at verse 29. Verse 29, for our God is a consuming fire. You know, God promised never to flood the earth again. He said, never again will I wipe out all flesh from before me with a flood. I will not cover the earth with the waters ever again. That's why he put the rainbow in the clouds. It was a symbol reminding God that he was withholding judgment from the earth. But there is a day coming. Are you listening? Saints and sinners alike in this place, there is a day that's coming when God will not flood the earth, but no, he will burn it up with fervent heat, the Bible says. There is a fire of God's wrath that is coming upon the earth that will be the end of all things as we know it. There's a day that's going to come where we're going to hear the trumpet sound. The eastern sky is going to split, and Jesus will be coming with a heavenly host, and he'll be coming for his church, and he will receive the church to himself. See, Jesus is the ark. Think about it. There were three levels: Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. There was one door which Noah entered and all of the animals. Only one way in. Jesus said, I am the door. He who enters by me will be saved. There was one window up top that brought the freshness of the air and brought the light in. See, the entrance of your word, O Lord, brings light and it brings life. See, saints, we don't have to fear that judgment day. Why? Because we'll be safe on the ark. We've prepared, and if we have persevered, he who endures to the end shall be saved. Wow. Which brings us to the last one for today, is that Noah was preserved. We don't have to fear troubled waters, because when we see the story of Noah, Noah prepared, Noah persevered, and Noah was preserved. You're there in Hebrews. Turn a couple books over, past James, past 1 Peter, find 2 Peter chapter number 2. 2 Peter chapter number 2. We see this in the story of Noah. 2 Peter chapter 2, verse number 5. Speaking of God, talking about how he didn't even spare the angels who rebelled. Verse number 5, it says, and he did not spare the ancient world, but saved Noah, one of 8 people, a preacher of righteousness, bringing in the flood on the world of the ungodly. Now drop down to verse number 9, it talks about Lot and how God brought Lot out of Sodom and Gomorrah when he rained fire and brimstone down on those ungodly places. And it says that if God knows how to deliver Noah, and if God knows how to deliver Lot, verse number 9, then the Lord knows how to deliver the godly out of temptations and to reserve the unjust under punishment for the day of judgment. Church, we do not have to fear the troubled waters. All we need to do is lock into the ark. His name is Jesus. Stay in, church. Stay in with him. Persevere. Endure. Be prepared for the coming of the day of the Lord. We need to be locked into Jesus. Now, I want to give you a warning, and then I want to give you an exhortation in closing. You're there in 2 Peter. Drop down to chapter number 3, verse number 17 and verse number 18. Last two verses in 2 Peter chapter number 3. Take a look at this with me. It says these words. It says, you therefore, beloved. You know who the beloved is? That's us. That's the church. You therefore, beloved, since you know this beforehand. Listen, you have been warned. You have been told about the coming of the day of the Lord. You know about salvation. You know about heaven and hell. You know about eternal punishment, justice of God. You know about the righteousness of God and how those who believe on the Lord shall be saved and call on his name, giving him all their heart and all their life. You know this beforehand. And he says, beware lest you also fall from your own steadfastness, being led away with the error of the wicked. See, there are people, as they hear us preaching righteousness, and they say, you're crazy. Your God's not loving. How could he do that? How could he condemn the world? How could he send people to hell? And we could back off and say, oh, well, you know, I don't want to offend anybody. I don't want to push you away from God. No, God is love. Come on in. God, let's just have a warm, fuzzy God. Kissy, kissy, lovey, lovey. Do whatever you want to do. It's still okay with God. No! There is a righteousness of God which is by faith, and we believe God, and God comes in and he changes us from the inside out. We're made new, and therefore we no longer have that old sin nature. Therefore, we don't do those things anymore. And there is a standard of righteousness that God brings to us, not only a position, but a practice in our life. It is the fruit of a heart that's been reborn. And he says, beware lest you be drawn away. See, it'd be very easy for us to rationalize and to say, well, you know what? I love these people, and therefore, well, how could I condemn them? You know what? I don't see anything wrong, and therefore, if God has pardoned all my sin, then God doesn't care if I do this, or God doesn't care if I have a little sip, or God doesn't care if I take a little puff, or God doesn't care if I mess around a little bit. I mean, he knows, he sees, he understands. That's why Jesus went to the cross. And we could rationalize it and count the blood of Jesus as a common thing. And yet, if we've trampled the Son of God underfoot, there's no one else going to the cross for our sins. We need to revere the blood of Jesus. We need to be ready. Now, let me give you the exhortation. That was the warning. Verse number 18, but grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. To him be the glory, both now and forever. Amen. See, let me encourage you, church. Stay in. Stay up. Grow in your walk with God. Get into the Word of God. Get the Word of God. Get faith in your heart. Be prepared. Get ready for the coming of the day of the Lord. Tell others about it. Get them ready too. Tell them, listen, you don't have to die in the fire that's coming on the earth. You don't have to perish for your sins. Jesus is the ark. You can be saved. You can come in. There is light and there is life for you. There is plenty of room. All who may come can come and be a part of this. Grow. Grow in the knowledge, grow in the grace, the ability which God gives. See, church, If we will prepare and we will persevere, then in the end, we will be preserved, just like we see in the life of Noah. Did you guys get something from the word of the Lord today? Come on, let's lift up Jesus today. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Now I want to take a moment before anyone leaves this place. And I want to make sure that your heart is right with God. It'd be a tragedy if we talked about judgment, talked about salvation, and we didn't give you the opportunity to check your own heart and your own life. Today, if you were to die, this was your last day on earth, or if Jesus were to come, I want to ask you, would you be ready? Would you be like Noah and his family who were on board and the Lord shut the door behind them? Or would you be like the world at that time that was outside saying, oh my God, Noah was right? Today, check yourself out. The Bible says it's good for us to examine ourselves, whether or not we're in the faith. And I want to make sure that your heart is right with God, and that if you died, that you would go to heaven and you wouldn't end up in hell. That if Jesus came, you would be one of the ones that he came for and you wouldn't get left behind. Today, I just want you to tune out everything else and lock into what God is speaking to you. What makes you think you're going to heaven? What makes you think that you're saved and that you're a Christian, that you would make it? Just answer that question in your heart. No one will know the answer but you and God. Maybe you said, well, you know, Pastor, I've been a really good person. I know God lets good people into heaven. But did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say you can be good enough to get into heaven? It doesn't work like that. You can't do enough good deeds to get into heaven because the standard is perfection. The only one who is perfect, his name is Jesus. You're not going to make it just by being good. Maybe you said, well, Pastor, I was raised in church. My parents told me we were Christians growing up. Hung a cross or St. Christopher around your neck. Had you baptized or christened as a child. Went to religious classes like Sunday school or catechism, Sabbath school class. You've always thought of yourself as a Christian. Born in America, America's a Christian nation. Everybody born in America is going to heaven. We're not any other religions. We're not Buddhist, Muslim, Hindus. Therefore, we're Christians headed for heaven, right? Wrong. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you're raised in church, parents tell you you're Christian, that makes you a Christian? Nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you wear religious jewelry, be baptized or christened as a child, attend religious classes, that you get to go to heaven. It doesn't work like that. And I love you enough, respect you enough, and honor you enough today to tell you the truth. You're not going to make it. Somebody said, well, Pastor, hold on a second, because not only when I was a child did I go to church. Here I am sitting in church right now in front of you. I believe that God's going to let me into heaven because I go to church. But did you know that nowhere in the Bible says you can sit in a sanctuary, warm up a spot, and that gets you right with God because you call yourself a Christian? That's like me going down to Dodger Stadium, wearing a Dodger uniform, bringing my bat and my ball, sitting in the dugout, calling myself a Dodger, and think that I'm going to get to play in the game. You know what's going to happen to me? They're going to find me sitting there, drag me out, and lock me up. Why? Because I'm not a Dodger. Just because I sit there and look like one and act like one, talk like one, doesn't make me one. Can't just sit in church service, call yourself a Christian, that makes you Christian. You say, but Pastor, hold on a second, because, you know, I volunteered at my last church. Didn't just sit in church, volunteered, helped out, sang in the choir, carried the pastor's Bible, made decisions. People thought of me as a leader. I even got a membership card to that church. That's great, I'm glad you did those things. Just show that to me in the Bible where that gets you into heaven. We're back to good works, aren't we? So you can't do enough to earn your way into heaven. Because our goodness compared to God's goodness are like filthy rags, going to get thrown out. And all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. We're not going to make it based on our own merit or our own goodness. You say, well, wait a second, because I know God. I know about Jesus and celebrate the resurrection, sing the songs at Christmas every year of my life. Doesn't that mean that I'm a Christian headed for heaven? I could quote scriptures. It's great. I'm glad you can do those things. Just show that to me in the Bible. You know, if you read your Bible, you know the demons believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. They're not Christians. Devil himself can quote scriptures. That doesn't qualify him for heaven. So everybody look up here at me for a second. This is not about what you have in your head. It's not about having head knowledge about who God is, and that gets you right with God, headed for heaven, denying hell. Rather, this is about your heart. Today, here's the real question. Have you given God all of your heart, and have you given God all of your life? If not, I love you enough to tell you the truth. You're not going to make it. But I want to give you an opportunity in a moment. I'm going to count to three just like this. One, two, three, bang, pop my hands together. When you hear the sound of my hands popping together, bang, just like that, that's your opportunity to raise your hand. What you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, I want to give God all my heart. I want to give God all my life. I want to be born again, headed for heaven, denying my presence in hell. I'll see your hand go up. I'll count it. You can put it right back down. Now you might be thinking, whoa, wait a second, time out. If I raise my hand, be embarrassed. Yeah, you might be. Let's get over that today. Because we already talked about it. Think about Noah. He had plenty of opportunity to be embarrassed. And yet he was one of 8 people that were saved. Are you going to let a moment of possible embarrassment keep you out of heaven forever and ever and ever, sending your soul to hell? Listen, no one would make that mistake. And yet the devil's going to try and talk you out of it right now. He's whispering in your ear, you don't need to do this, you're fine, just keep going on. He's crazy, this guy. Your flesh is trying to hold you back. Oh my goodness, what are people going to think of me? And yet today you need to take a bold stand. It's time to stand up. It's time to say yes. It's time to make a choice, to make a change. Love you enough today to tell you the truth. Because without it, you're not going to make it. Listen, if you landed in hell, you would raise everything you could. Your hands, your arms, your legs, your feet, your underwear on a flagpole if you had to. But there are no exits in hell. But yet today, here's a Noah, a preacher of righteousness, giving you the opportunity to get on the boat. Will you give God all of your heart? Will you give God all of your life? Who should raise your hand if you've been running from God instead of to God? I'm speaking to you. Who should raise your hand if you're not sure about your salvation? Today is your day. Make sure. Who should raise your hand if you've never done this, never said yes to Jesus, given him all of your heart and all of your life? Come on, I'm speaking to you. Finally, who should raise their hand? Let's see if this describes your heart. You're a little in, little out, little up, little down, little token prayer every now and again, an occasional church attendance. God is something in your life, but he's not everything. And you're not opposed to God, but you're not wholehearted for God. Listen, if that's your relationship with Jesus, you're not going to make it. How do I know that? Because only people that are not real Christians are not going to make it. And Jesus said this. He said, when I come, I want to find you hot or I want to find you cold, because if I find you lukewarm, I'll vomit you from my mouth. Listen, only people that are not real Christians will be ejected and rejected from the body of Christ. So if I just describe the condition of your heart, come on, you can make a right relationship with God. Simply raising your hand in a safe and friendly church service. Who should raise their hand all across this auditorium? Come on, back in the family rooms, wherever you're at, watching by television in the foyer, down at the Love Rock Cafe. Come on, put the burger down. Get ready to get your hand up if you need to do this. Then come into the church service, telling us you're right afterwards. Online, hey, God sees and God is watching. And then you can click the button, blue button, if you minimize your video screen that says respond to God, or go to our homepage, How to Know God. Someone will lead you in a prayer. I'm going to count to three. Pop my hands together. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. Here we go. 1, 2, 3. Let me see your hands. Just raise them up high for me right now if that's you. There's 1, 2, 3. God bless you guys. 3 wise people already. 4, 5. Got you over there. Who else today? Need to give God all of your heart. Need to give God all of your life. Up on top, there's 6 and 7. Got you guys. Thank you. Who else today? 7 wise people. I think I got you already. If I seen your hand already, you can put it down. About 7, 8. Got you over there. Thank you. Thank you. Who else today? About 8 wise people. Number 9. You're sitting there wondering if you should do this. You should do this. Go for it. 9 back there got you. Thank you. Thank you, number 9. Don't you just feel number 10? Number 10, come on. Let's go for God today. Come on. Offering you life with God forever and ever. Come on. There's a place for you. There's room for you here. If that's you, you need to give God all your heart, all of your life. Where are you at, number 10? Come on. Let's go for God today. Remember, faith, then the fear of the Lord. If you're trembling in this place and you say, man, I don't want to endure that judgment, you don't have to. You're being offered the greatest gift you could ever receive right now. Come on, will you be bold enough to take that stand? Lift your hand in this safe and friendly place. I didn't embarrass them. I won't embarrass you. Come on, number 10. Raise it up high for me when I'm looking your direction. Where are you at? Where are you at, number 10? Come on, let's go. Yeah, they're pointing over here, but I don't see if you got your hand up, just give me a little wave if that's you. Where are you at? Thank you, number 10. Got you back there. God bless you. All right, come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise for about 10 wise people. Hallelujah. So good, so good. All 10 of you, you number 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, you should have raised your hand, but you didn't. It's not too late. Here's what I want you to do. In a moment, we're all going to stand. We're all going to give a clap and a shout. As we do, once you get a hold of your coat, purse, sweater, Bible, a friend if you need a friend. Get your stuff, in other words. Whatever you brought with you to church. Get a friend if you need a friend, and I want you to get in the aisle and meet me up front, because we're going to change destinies today. Can't do that till we get you down here. So let's all stand and welcome them. No one leave during this time. Let the Holy Spirit draw them to themselves. And you come right now. If that's you, you need to come. You raise your hand, or you should have raised your hand. Make your way to the front right now. Come on down. Come on down.
Jesus, I believe.
Hallelujah, they're coming. Come on, you can come too. This is your time. This is your moment.
Jesus, I belong to you. You're the reason that I live.
Come on, they're coming. From the family rooms, you need to bring Jesus, your children. Come on down, they'll remember this.
Jesus, I belong.
Even if you didn't raise your hand, you just come right now. Come on down to the front.
You're the reason that I live.
They're still coming.
You're the reason.
They're still coming. Come on, you can come too.
Jesus, I believe.
Somebody else, if you need to come, just make your way to the front right now. Come on down.
Jesus, I believe.
All right. Will you guys give me just a moment? Because I don't think everybody that raised their hand, I don't think everybody that needs to come has come. This is not a game. This is not for me to feel good about myself. Just like Noah, I will be a fool for you. And if you're going to get to heaven, you got to get there God's way. Can I say to you like this? Not all roads lead to heaven. It's like saying I could drive around the earth and make it to the moon. You're never going to make it. One way you're going to get there. The same way, can't just do your thing, be true to yourself, and expect that you're going to make it into heaven. You got to do it God's way. It's God's heaven. And today, I want to offer you one more opportunity to come down here and receive this wonderful gift of salvation. God already paid it all. The blood of Jesus on the cross. We don't have to endure the wrath of God for sin any longer. It's been poured out on Jesus. And yet there is a day that's coming where Jesus will come for his own, and there will be a punishment that's poured out on the ungodly, those that didn't enter. And so I want to make sure, and I want to plead with you, just come right now while I'm talking. They're still coming. That's you. They're coming. Come on. Follow the leading of the Spirit. If that's you, God's speaking to you right now. Don't clap. Let's just let them come. You sense a fear. It's the fear of the Lord. You've heard the word of God. Say, I don't want to be motivated by fear. Listen, this is a godly fear. It's a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God, the Bible says. God loves you so much, he sent Jesus. Now will you offer him what he wants, what he already gave you, all of your heart, all of your life. Anybody else, real quick? If you have come, if that's you, you need to come. Just get down here. Run down here. Come on. Anyone else? Anyone else? I'm going to wrap this up and another moment, and I don't want you to miss out. All right, praise the Lord. Hey, thank God you guys have come. So excited for you guys. All right? Best decision of your life right here, okay? Want to introduce you guys to a friend of mine right over here to my right, your left. This is Pastor Joel. He's a really good guy. Nothing weird's going to go on. You know, sometimes you go to church, you wonder, are they weird? Listen, I'm about as weird as it's going to get with the socks, okay? That's about it, all right? He's cool. He's going to do three things with you. Thank you for coming, all right? He's going to do three things. He's going to lead you in a prayer to invite Jesus into your heart. You're going to be born again. Then he's going to give you some free information, some free literature to find out what to do next in your walk with God. After that, he'll introduce you to a program we have here called Spiritual Personal Trainers. Basically, let me describe it to you like this. It's a friend in church who will help you get strong in the ways of the Lord. He'll describe how it works. It's easy, it's free, and you need to do it. Now listen, let me make a promise to you guys. Give us 1 year. 1 year of your life here at the Rock Church and World Outreach Center, sitting consistently under the teaching of God here at the Rock. After that year and for the rest of your life, here's the promise. I promise that you will look around and you'll say, my goodness, I did not know I could be this blessed. I am so blessed. Am I telling the truth, everybody? All right, take their word for it, okay? That 1 year all starts with a spiritual personal trainer. He'll describe how it works, then he'll let you come right back out. Your friends and family, they will wait for you, okay? If you guys make a left turn, follow Pastor Joel right this way. Come on, let's give him a hand as they go. Hallelujah!
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer, of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son and that you sent him for me and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.